Good afternoon, everybody. I want to talk to you today about being evil and how not to be evil, to be specific. Those three words, don't be evil, were a famous part of Google's code of conduct. Well, they were at least until April last year, that is, when they were replaced by the much more prosaic Alphabet code of conduct, which simply states that the company will try not to fall foul of the law. And that's exactly the thing. It is tempting to be a little bit evil. Take Google itself. Earlier this year, just after they updated their code of conduct, they agreed to capitulate on their own internal brand values by agreeing to China's state censorship of the internet, something they said they would never do before. And as a part of this devil's deal, not only are they going to censor the internet and the free flow of information, they're also going to share Chinese citizens' personal data with the Chinese government for that government to use as a part of their soon-to-be-mandatory social credit scores. Now, these social credit scores are going to be used to limit Chinese citizens' access to things like housing, education, freedom of movement, and even, believe it or not, access to who you can marry in that country. So not exactly not evil, is it? But it's not just big tech brands that compromise on their values for low-lying fruits. Makeup brands, including fan favorites like MAC and Revlon, have also been known to bend their values a little bit and submit to animal testing and horrible vivisection practices in order to get a shot at export markets that demand those practices. This is something they would be entirely embarrassed to do in their home markets. But the thing is, if you start capitulating on your values, you are definitely going to lose out in the long run. 2/3 of millennial and Gen Z consumers expect the brands that they work for and the brands that they support in terms of the purchases they make to reflect their values. This means there's no more separation of brand and state. Now, if you call the zeitgeist correctly, as Nike did by appointing controversial brand ambassadors such as Caster Semenya and Colin Kaepernick, and you can enjoy really great rewards. By hiring and standing by Colin Kaepernick, Nike gained over 170,000 Instagram followers and a healthy sales spike. But that's all great. However, these sort of successes also lead other brands to be tempted to give in to virtue signaling or backing brand activism campaigns that they don't really believe in. A great example here would be L'Oreal, who hired and fired not one but two controversial brand ambassadors in very quick succession. First, they hired the very outspoken African-American transgender model, Monroe Bergdorf, and then days later fired her over tweets she had made speaking out against white privilege. Hardly surprising, right? But no, they didn't learn from their mistake there at all. Months later, they hired and promptly fired again their first ever hijab-wearing hair model, Amina Khan, over tweets she had made speaking out against the Israeli occupation of the West Bank. Once again, hardly surprising. And this sort of shallow brand wagoning is not going to win you any loyalty from your consumers in the long run. But that's just the start of it. We're now seeing brands not only being active in social justice issues, we're starting to see brands appointing themselves as judge, jury, priest, and executioner. With morality marketing, brands are trying to really punish people for bad behavior. A great example here would be the football clubs, Chelsea and Lazio, both of which have now insisted that fans that are caught engaging in anti-Semitic behavior will be forced to go on holiday to a club-mandated tour of Auschwitz to learn to atone for their sins. Now, this sort of morality marketing is well and good, but it also has a temptation to sneak into the evil territory when you start to use your brand's influence for corporate censorship or for propaganda, as Facebook was accused of doing in the American elections that saw Donald Trump come to power, and they were caught out during that huge Cambridge Analytica scandal. Now, not only are brands engaging in propaganda, they're also getting involved in what we call behavioral economics or nudge theory, and basically using the shortcuts in humans' minds in order to manipulate behavior, Much like these optical illusion speed bumps on the screen, trick drivers into slowing down. A benevolent version of this would be Discovery and its Vitality program, which rewards you for good exercise and good behavior. However, you can also step into evil behavior modification territory, if you like, when brands start using that nudge theory to build addictive, unhealthy social media platforms and video games. And of course, as these brands and businesses that collect our data and use this data to manipulate us become more and more powerful, it's inevitable that states and governments are going to start relying on these businesses more and more for actually running of their countries. Once again, there's a good side. Take a brand such as Uber that is now sharing its rider user data with city planners so the city planners can build better, more efficient, less traffic congested networks. But then there's the bad side again. Just like I spoke about earlier with brands like Google, selling out their consumers to less than altruistic governments. Now, the moral of this whole story I'm telling you today is really that all brands and all businesses have two choices. They can either go after the low-lying fruit, which may involve being a little bit evil, or you can take the high road and build a long-term values, ethics, trust, mutually respectful relationship with your consumers. In a world where today, Yale University says that the average Fortune 500 company will only be around for 10 to 15 years, if I wanted my business to last for the long run, I know which road I would choose. To end with, to quote from Superman, with great power comes great responsibility. In a world where great data is great responsibility and is great power, the challenge is for all of you sitting in this room to use that power for good and not for evil. Thank you.